for his hovercraft back.
That'd be ridiculous. She can't come back now. She's mythic.
I set aside my dreams for the turning world and its whispers. The circle encircles the fire without flame. Tears yet to fall crystallize my brain and freeze. Breathe. Pain nor joy hides its face for you. They stand, a reminder of humanity, in space, instilled with a willingness magnetized by conflict. Will you speak? Will you speak to my hesitation? I will never ask you to save me. Will you speak? Delayed decay in a loveless way, for the heart is strong but out of time, and words on beauty's paper bleed, and that which is written does not concede anything, let alone what it means to be. Thunder cracks and crashes alone, a never-ending chorus in the name of noise. I listen speechless in the wake of its echo. I will never ask you to save me.
My failure was in being so slow to grasp Quinn's plan. She let the capital and the districts destroy one another, then she stepped in to take power of a 13's arsenal. Oh, make no mistake, she intends to take my place now. But I've been watching you, and you watching me. I'm afraid we've both been played for fools.
Hello, my name's Kay Channon, and other than having really frizzy hair right now, for a reason that I can't place, I am the writer, director, producer, music producer, set designer, editor, writer, performer, director, camera person, when it was not known scenes from The Hunger Games itself, of How the Feathers Fell, which is a Hunger Games fan-made film that I created for my PhD. So it's now all up on YouTube for everybody to view. But what people don't have any idea of is what I went through to make the film, which was quite a lot of things, which I could never... I could never speak about everything in this one documentary. It would be impossible. There were so many aspects. But I'm just going to try and cover what I consider to be the most significant, most difficult, and most enjoyable parts of making the film, despite it being created during the outbreak of COVID-19. Beginning in February 2020. So to get the film finished, edited and subtitled took 3 years. So how can I condense those 3 years and what can I talk about in that time? Well, one, the archery isn't real, as you could probably guess, in a sense that I used 2 bows during the filming, both of which were fake, for obvious reasons. One, like Jennifer Lawrence, I'm not a professional archer. There was no way during a shielding program where I was just filming the film in the accommodation flat or in this. There are a couple of scenes which I put in after, at the end of shielding, which were filmed in this room. So nothing was filmed outside. If it looks like it's outside, that was a TikTok filter.
just heading towards the left flank.
Okay. Can you give me a tree right there?
Sure. Two and three.
Almost there.
Lucia, get a camera.
If it looks like it's raining, that was a TikTok filter also. If it looks like I'm injured, that really depends. Sometimes I was, not because my archery was bad, but because I had to go to A&E for emergency blood draws, and or I was actually really sick. So what made the archery harder is this arm got really messed up through them not being able to get blood out, and I think it's part three when Katniss is actually wounded. I'm also wounded in part three. I've also had to basically risk my life going to A&E while 80% of the A&E has COVID and get a blood draw because I have got so poorly from an infection, which I've acquired, even though I've not been outside or been in contact with anybody other than a primary carer who's all in PPE, just because I have a very weak immune system. And unfortunately, they tried out my arm several times, and you can see that in part three. So for some of the archery scenes, I'm working with an already painful arm. I'm a left-hander, a rubber-ended arrow, and a very, very poor aim because I have a low-grade fever. And then I'm dealing with the post-production effects to not make the arrows look like they're fake, so not have the rubber ends on, which they all had. To not make the bows look like they're fake. So I think on average, archery shots would take around 3 hours. There was one particular shot which I will slot in right after this clip here, which took 4.5 hours, including post-production, syncing sound, sorting out backgrounds, doing the shot. Literally, that was a terrible day. So that was my least favorite thing. Unlike in Jennifer Lawrence's shots, my bow always had to be loaded with something. Whereas if you watch the behind the scenes for Catching Fire, sometimes the bow is empty and all she's doing is pulling it back and releasing it. And believe me, that alone hurts because it pings back onto your hand. So my left hand permanently hurt pretty much whenever I was doing an archery scene. And there was no option. It was like, well, I'll have to get it right, however long it takes. And so that's not something I would want to repeat. But what I did really enjoy is the crossover between the known Hunger Games film and myself. So kind of becoming Katniss Everdeen as Jennifer Lawrence would have. So here is that clip that took 4.5 hours.
Katniss, help me!
Bram! Bram!
No.
Bram! Katniss, wait! Bram! Bram!
No,
it's not her.
Annie!
It's not her. It's just a Jabberjay. It's not her.
How do you think they got that sound? Jabberjay's copy.
So on the other end of the spectrum, what did I enjoy most and what do I wish I could do again? Two things. Fiddle about with TikTok and iMovie filters. Yes. Nobody taught me anything about filming. I'd never made a film before. I didn't know anything about post-production. I'd never used TikTok before. So that was a really, really fun process. It could also look really, really bad, but it could also look really, really good, I was discovering. So if I had a chance to do that again, I would. The problem is any audio that isn't yours often gets removed by TikTok. So I had to keep those clips private and then film my computer screen and then insert them into the film afterwards. In the film, two settings actually appear. This room, when shielding was over and I needed to do a couple more, or should I say redo a couple more shots, and my university accommodation room. That's it. So basically, this is one of the sets you are seeing I'm sitting in now. Like, literally, that's all I had. And an iPhone 7 pre-owned and a MacBook 2015 to film on. So I'm very, very pleased about how those shots came out. And I would love to do some of those shots again. What else would I love to do again? Well, Macathon signing, because I've become so much better at it. I would love to film those scenes again. I'm still signing with Singing Hands Choir. You will see I earned that shirt by part 9. And if you look in another place on this channel, you will find a playlist that says My Best Macathon Videos. So I do sign and translate Macathon to music for fun. Even though I don't have to anymore because the film is over, I still enjoy it. Has come from that? Well, Macathon, which is for the hearing, but for people that have communication and learning difficulties that create barriers with speech, comes from British Sign Language. So I've also got my level 1 British Sign Language since finishing the film. Or while I was finishing the film, because level 1 takes 10 months minimum. And I'm now on to level 2. It's been a very useful experience, a eye-opening experience. I feel like if I hadn't done the Macathon and continued with that, I wouldn't have. I wouldn't have even tried to do British Sign Language. Because that was the basis of the Macathon system. What was kind of the most fluctuating part of the process? Singing, because I have quite weak and bad lungs, and I was also very poorly. So the fact that I even sung in the film at all still amazes me sometimes. Sometimes it was just the iPhone 7 mobile mic, and sometimes it was a standard USB plug-in mic. Bearing in mind, all this equipment was not any further on than 2015. Trust me and believe me. Everything was made either in 2015 or pre-2015, and I was filming in 2020 with all this equipment. Rendering was annoying because I was just sitting there looking at the little round circle going, please render without any, you know, gaps or jolts. And then if there was, that would sometimes mean reshooting. What else was fun? Being inventive, so inventive, because I didn't have costume. So literally using what I had and filters to change costumes, to change clothes. And use the moments that I was crying in the film, like actually crying. Again, this is kind of deviating from the original question, because obviously nobody wants to be forced into a space where they are physically crying. But the moments in the film where I look ill or upset or I'm crying are very real. That's what made some of the singing harder, because there was emotion in that. I think I'd like to do the hanging tree again, although I never wrote any of it down. It was just spontaneously sung into my phone, and then I transferred it onto the computer and then sung it again with the USB mic over the original. So there's like two layers of my voice in one version. And I did that whilst attached to oxygen, if you wonder what the additional sound was. So I think for me, although that lends something very special and unique about the song, particularly because I changed the lyrics apart from the hanging tree part, I would love to be able to repeat it. One of my friends, you know who you are, two of them actually, provided me with some amazing piano and also some vocals on a couple of the musical clips I used. So even though we were hundreds and hundreds of miles apart, their piano and sometimes their voice features in the film, which was great. Also another learning curve, something I'd love to do more of, but takes hours and hours to put your vocals with somebody else's vocals and a piano track. If I wasn't using a mobile mic, I was just using this standard plug-in. Let's see, it's got a USB end here. And a little stand, but that's the only mic I had. I didn't even have a spit guard. And I'd love to do more of that, but that was very long. I'll tell you what else was very long, subtitling. And during part 9, or should I say the editing of part 9, I had some surgery, some minor surgery on this arm. So all of part 9, fun fact for you, because you weren't me, was subtitled with one hand. My left hand was me doing this for hours on end. I would not recommend going into an over 20 minute or 20 minute-ish clip without subtitles and saying, yeah, I'll do that with one hand. It was literally because to fit in with all the marketing material up till that point, the film had to be done and out and rendered and running on YouTube by the end of 2023. Otherwise, none of the trailers, music videos, or anything I made to go with How the Feathers Fell would match. So then I was under a lot of pressure. That's the only reason why I even attempted with one hand. I wouldn't recommend. It's long enough with two hands and with an AI assistant that is not accurate at all. One-handed, no. I was nearly in tears how long this took and how it misheard, words. I put them on. Man, if you're subtitling, give yourself time, pace yourself, take screen breaks, and definitely have the use of two hands. I think just having the confidence, although it was fun, and I hope people do laugh at points because there are some funny kind of part, it's not comical, but you know, funny sections where I, in well-known scenes, I am lip-syncing to Katniss Everdeen's dialogue, or I am replacing Katniss Everdeen's dialogue with my own voice. But boy, is it hard. Is it hard to make lip-syncing look good?
Thank you. My stylist is such an idiot. District 7, lumber, trees. Oh, I'd love to put my axe in her face. So what do you think? Now that the whole world wants to sleep with you.
I don't think that the whole world...
I wasn't talking to you.
Okay.
You want zip?
And then when you spend ages also on going back to the microphone, on balancing your sound and getting the singing right and getting the thing right, and then the person's record label goes, yo, you can't use that. And you go, oh my God. Like, this was me at the time. Oh my God, I've got to sing that solo because the current record label of Evanescence took it out totally, and I'm like, oh crud it. And I really didn't feel confident at all, so had to redo that. Then Taylor Swift's record label took the whole of the Safe and Sound scene down because they said I was not allowed to use, so it was up with a copyright strike, as I expected to. And then I woke up the next morning and the whole section was down. So it had premiered, and then the record label came in and said, nah. And I was like, ha, this is so bad. I did not expect this because Safe and Sound is in other places on YouTube and it's fine. So then I had to get a cover by the wonderful Madeline Bailey, who is a YouTuber. So then I had to take Taylor Swift out and put Madeline Bailey in, but change the speed and everything because her version of Safe and Sound was different to Taylor Swift. Naturally, nobody's going to do a cover that is identical. And man, getting that in time, because I lip sync, as you should do with Mac songs, it's not for the deaf, every single word with Macaton and sign was crazy. Like, imagine getting that to match audio that it wasn't originally built for. Hold on to this lullaby, even when the music's gone. Just close your eyes. The sun is going down. You'll be alright. No one can hurt you now. Chan, that was 10 hours of my life I'll never get back. And I say that, like, as in, I never want to go through that again. But when you think, I was in shielding, I wasn't going anywhere, I wasn't seeing anybody, I wasn't really beholding to a deadline. So, like, what else was I going to do for 10 hours other than sit and cry and stare at a wall? So it was a good use of 10 hours. And that comes on to the final thing, I guess, that we should really talk about, which is the pros and cons of doing a massive project like this solo. So I believe the film, it actually exceeds 3 hours. If something doesn't look right or come out right, it's on you. You're doing makeup, costume, editing, you're basically scripting, you're controlling the background, lighting, dialogue, like cutting, switching between like you and the kind of known Hunger Games clips and narratives. You're working with actors that aren't really there.
Katniss Everdeen? What are you doing here?
I came to see you.
What about the baby?
I lost it.
You fighting Katniss? You're here to fight with us?
I am. I will.
So you're re-watching and rereading The Hunger Games purely relying on memory and kind of treating it as a real on-set film experience. And then watching everything at the end of the day and deciding what's usable and what is rubbish. And sometimes not really being able to decide what to keep, what to cut. There is a deleted scene reel, but I didn't put them all in. So I think actually there's about an hour let's say there's an hour of content that I didn't use. It's good because it's entirely up to you how you shoot things, what you look like, how you say things, how things come out. But on the flip side of that, it is work. It is work. If anything, as a whole, filming it is the easy bit, as we would say in Makaton. Editing, post-production, all the effects, blah, 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 lining everything up, you end up with hours and hours of this footage. And you also end up with the kind of, wow, I'm alive and didn't get COVID before there was a vaccine. Kind of amazed experience. You're staying behind, being alone and making this project, and only switching carers when you absolutely have to, although that's always a risk that they would bring COVID in from transportation. Going without food, being very sick, all of that, it not only kind of protects you and the rest of your family from dying, so you kind of technically survive your own Hunger Games, but you have this artistic product, you know, at the end, and you just think, oh my gosh, where do I begin? Sometimes things, to be honest, I'll be honest with you, that looked all right, still didn't go in the film because I felt it didn't really drive the narrative forward. It's about actually, like, asking myself, like, what does this scene do for the overall, like, because I'm doing it by parts. What does this scene say to part one? What does it say to the viewer? Rather than, oh, that's the coolest, like, TikTok filter I ever found ever, and I really like that song, so it's going in the film. No, it wasn't. No, it's not necessarily like that. I mean, if it looks good and it contributes to the narrative and everything's on point, that's great. That's amazing. Like, all of it is. But for it to all be there for every single shot was not possible. So sometimes you have to strip it back and say, okay, it's not about it looking fancy at this point. It's about what we are saying at this point. So it's literally like, why am I doing this? What am I saying to the audience at this point? It's not just because I'm I'm really enjoying, which I must admit I did. I'm really enjoying being able to embody Katniss Everdeen, despite the wheelchair, the infections, the terrible archery, everything. Enjoying it, pure enjoyment, was not enough to make it into the film. It was not. It never was. But I just like to think it's as rewarding, I hope, for a Hunger Games fan that gets a chance to see, even if it's just one or two parts of it, than it was for me to stand back and say, like, I made that all by myself. Yes, I had a Makaton teacher, an advisor for the signing, but everything else I did and worked out alone. I didn't have any help, and I'm not a professional filmmaker. I'm not a professional film producer. I look back at it kind of in disbelief sometimes that it was all, every element was me. It was all about getting it right, getting it edited, learning the signing, not forgetting stuff, not destroying my room with the bow and the fake arrows, even though it was really, really, really difficult. That was all on me, and somehow it happened. It's still amazing to me sometimes. And I hope that gives you a insight into the making of the film and kind of understand and appreciate the joys, the difficulties and the hurdles, or at least some of them, that I went through making it. If you've lasted to the end of this video, thank you very much for watching. If you wish to see the film and you haven't already, just look for the How the Feathers Fell playlist and it's all there, like I say, with or without subtitles. And happy Hunger Games, and may the odds be ever in your favour.